Hello, I'm Mark Riccati, and this is 50 Plus. Again, we are honored. This is the second segment that we are doing on the Merchant Marine. It's my great pleasure and great honor to see the Merchant Marine begin to get a little more recognition, which is long overdue. I have read that one naval commentator said, "We can afford to lose men, but we cannot afford to lose tonnage." And that's cold-blooded. It's terrible. And what I've been impressed with in talking to you gentlemen is that you were so young and you had no idea how important what you were doing, that the entire war effort, whether it was in the Pacific or in the Atlantic, that so much depended on whether or not you people were there to deliver. In the last program, I mentioned the fact that more than 5,000 merchant marine ships were sunk, that there was a loss of the Allies of more than 50,000 merchant marines, and you people are survivors. But I think that we, particularly who live on Staten Island and look out at the ships coming and going, should remember a time when it was with great fright and great hope that the ships passed by. So, I'd like to let you people talk because you're certainly the experts on this. I'm not.
Well, the whole thing is we wanted to get our licks in. And for the most part, myself, I was too young to go into any of the services, so I went into the Merchant Marine, left high school. And this was.
That's interesting.
In those days, you know, you wanted to get into the war.
That's right.
Nationalism, patriotism was at a high, much more so than today.
Although there still are people who were in Korea and the Gulf War.
Well, there are also, you know, people who obey orders in the services, and they go where they're called. And since we couldn't go into the services, well, at least I couldn't, Merchant Marine was my effort. As a matter of fact, I trained in Huffman Island, the Merchant Marine Training Station right there, which is just off South Beach.
There was also one at Sheepshead Bay,
I think.
And now, of course,
correct.
There's the academy at Kings Point on Long
Kings
Island.
Kings Point, well, that was the Officers Academy, mm-hmm. And it still is.
Yeah, well, that's where I went, 16 years of age. That's when I went.
16?
Yeah, Merchant Marine, you were able to go in at 16. So that's why we went in, my buddy and I. We went to see it.
Were you from Staten Island?
No, I came from Brooklyn. But I went to Sheepshead Bay, and that's where I took the training.
Yeah.
Then when we finished.
Did you have any idea what you were getting into?
None whatsoever. I've never been aboard a ship in my life. And the first ship I went aboard, ironically sailing out of San Francisco, didn't even pass the Golden Gate Bridge. I got seasick. Every trip I took, and it's a funny thing about being seasick, you know, you don't realize it. Like passing under the Golden Gates, we were batting down the hatches. Next thing I knew, I was heaving up, and I never stopped.
Oh,
and
boy.
The day I did stop, it's the day I got drafted. They said I was.
Well, one reason why I went in, I was thinking after the war. And I figured if I survived, they'll be letting a lot of guys out of the military, and there'll be a lot of people unemployed. And I figured if I survived, the ships will still be sailing, and I would have a job. And as it worked out, I had a job all my life.
So you stayed with the Merchant Marine?
Just until 2 years ago.
Wow.
I went in the end of 1943, and
that was the most dangerous
About three days before I was 18 years old.
Were you in the Atlantic at all during that terrible time with the
I only sailed during the war in the Atlantic and the Mediterranean later on. But it did work out that way.
Does that mean that you were also in ships that could have been in danger during the Korean War, Vietnam?
Well, I wasn't Korea too, excuse me. I wasn't a Korea War. For a month, we brought a full load on a Liberty ship, a full load of phosphate from Rotterdam, Holland. And we went the other way through the Suez Canal. And people running the canal, they made us water down the cargo holds going through the Suez Canal. because they said explosive, explosive. Because they knew darn well they were going to use the phosphate.
So if you had been torpedoed, you would have had double or God knows what.
We didn't worry too much about torpedoes in Korea.
This isn't worried about fire.
But they were going to use that phosphate for explosives. That's why they made us water down the hole.
Of course.
That was during the Korean War. But as I said, I had a job after the war, and a lot of people didn't, you know, because they cut everything
cut
down.
Back.
Well, I think some people wouldn't want to get back on the ship.
I left the Merchant Marine and left the Merchant Marine, went into the U.S. Navy. I was in the submarine service in 1944 and stayed in it for 2 years. And during my time there, I was, in addition to on the American U-boats, American submarines.
That's brilliant.
coming in from action one day in New London, I saw a German U-boat that was tied up on across the way on the same pier. So I asked the Marine guard if I could go aboard to look at it. They said, go ahead, and I did. So I went down below and found I don't remember what it was, electrician or an engineman, cursing and trying to make head or tail out of the labels that were on the gauges and the valves, the switches. So I'm Danish, and the Danish mechanical language is very similar to German. So I was reading the labels off for him so he could put them down
but
in his log book.
The irony that you are reading labels on a German U-boat.
Oh, that's you don't really know the irony. 2 days later, I was transferred to that boat. I served on that U-boat until I was discharged.
Really?
You sink any American ships?
No, I hope not.
Sir,
no,
where
we just practice operations.
Where
I went to Kings Point.
Did you?
Yes.
I got an officer guy.
One of those guys. May 1st, 1942, I signed. And then I had preliminary training for 3 months. After that...
That's very short by today's terms.
Well, it was 3 months preliminary. It's supposed to be 6 months advanced training, and then out.
How old were you then?
I was 20. No, I went in 19. I was 20 that July. And after the 3 month preliminary training, I was sent down to Baltimore, Maryland, three other cadets. Joined John W. Brown. She's still around. She's down in Baltimore now. It was a museum ship. And that was my first trip.
What sort of things did you carry?
We carried 20 tanks on deck and miscellaneous. We had powder, we had machinery parts, we had one crated airplane up on number two hatch. And we went down, this is the best part, we left Baltimore in September, we went to Brooklyn.
This is 42.
This is 42, we loaded up in Brooklyn. October 1st, we left Brooklyn, went down to Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, in convoy. We had PC boats, little tiny things, you know, the big wave.
U-boats were operating down
there. Oh, yes, we were scared to death. At least I was, anyhow.
That's where we got the idea for Torpedo Junction.
Big wave, you know, they disappeared, couldn't see
them. Torpedo Junction, Caribbean.
Caribbean was Torpedo Junction.
Yeah, my first trip was down to Torpedo Junction.
We had one four-piper.
I had a vacation down there.
The Barry was escort commanded, plus about two of these PC boats. Yeah. And then at night they dropped that charge. What's all that noise out there? And you'll find out in a hurry. Scared the hell out of me, you know. So went to Guantanamo Bay, and then we went over to Panama, through the Panama Canal. We're traveling alone now, through the Panama Canal, down the west coast of South America, round Cape Horn, across the bottom of South Atlantic, to Cape Town. Cape Town, we went up Indian Ocean outside of Madagascar.
Did you feel you were in danger at any time? Were you in convoy?
No, we traveled alone. Hopefully there was no German submarines in those particular zones, areas.
But there were Japanese submarines.
It was an Italian submarine sank one of the ships that followed us later on.
Really?
Yes.
Were you in danger from the kamikaze pilots?
Oh, we didn't get that far. That was over in Japan. But we went up to Iran, a place called Karamshah in the Persian Gulf. We got up there Christmas Day, 1942, and I think we left March 17th, 1943. Just fooled around. the docks weren't even completed in most cases, and no place to unload the cargo. And then you had the Iranians unload, which, and they were pretty useless, I guess. Most people know. And then we come back.
Well, it was 43 that I understand were the wonder years. The Germans called it the wonder year, from January through March, when they had more than 500 American ships, I believe,
yeah, that was
in that period. It was a terrible time.
HX-229
was another wonder time for them. But were you aware of the number of American ships or Allied ships?
No,
we never had any idea.
We had no idea.
Casualties were at sea.
Of course they wouldn't tell you. I mean, hey guys, you want to go out and get killed?
Yeah. It's confidential information.
Well, ones we knew about was the ones we saw.
We saw going down, yeah. Yeah.
You saw ships going down?
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
They saw after they went down.
That North Atlantic was a beaut.
You could walk across on ships.
Not only the weather you had.
And one of you was telling me before the program that you couldn't stop and pick up survivors because it would endanger your ship.
Right. If you're submarine talking, you had to go.
As a matter of fact, we were in convoy once. That's about them depth charges. And one of the ships broke down. And, you know, the escort can only stay with it a certain amount of time.
Right.
Yeah. And then about 2 hours later, you can hear it. She got hit.
Yeah,
got
knocked.
She went down. You could see the fireball back where you just came from.
We had an incident like that. We were in convoy, and we had a Greek ship aboard, and they could do maybe 6-7 knots, you know. And he was in convoy. He's in one of the middle columns, way at the rear, you know. And we're going along, and then he keeps falling back. So the Commodore sends up a hoist, you know, and we all answer the hoist, you know. Close up to the Greek ship. The convoy had numbers, you know, column and the ship within the column. They had
the signal flag. Yeah.
So you could identify the ships. So, look back, this guy's still fooling around. So then he sends up a hoist, German submarines in the area. You saw a cloud of smoke, and that guy must have pushed it up to about 12 knots. It was right up past, yeah, he went past us, and we were toward the end of the convoy.
Someone referred to that as the coffin?
No, that was the tankers. When you sailed the tankers, you were in Coffin's Corner.
The Coffin Corner.
You're all by yourself, all alone out there, because if you blew up, they didn't want you to take any other ships with them.
It was the last column last ship, or the first column last ship.
But the tank went up with one big fat ball of fire, and that's all. Nobody's there. It's complete incineration.
Yeah. I was in the engine room, so the chief engineer comes down, and he hands me a bucket of oak plugs and a wooden mallet. He says, "Here." I says, "What's that? What is that for?" He says, "You'll see." He says, "When you see water leaking, you plug a hole." And as I'm down the lower engine room, I heard, boing, and here comes a rivet past me. So you go there with a plug and you tap it in. You don't realize what you're doing.
These are riveted ships.
18-year-old.
Yeah, riveted. Very old riveted ships. Riveted plugs.
Don't realize what they're doing. You just think, oh, well, that's funny. Pop another hole.
Wind up with a little piece of Swiss cheese there.
Yeah. Before you know it, you run through 100 pegs. So what happened here? Then after you get out and watch and you come up on deck and say, "How'd you make out?" "I used the whole bucket." He says, "Yeah, you know what you were doing?" I says, "Well, the rivets were coming out." He says, "Yeah, you know what the rivets hold, don't you?" That holds the ship together.
Right. We not only had to contend with submarines, airplanes, we had to contend with the ships, depth charge, and the ships we sailed.
Not realizing.
They would break apart on us.
Well, you had ships from World War I, too.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Whose tanker I was on?
The first ship I was on was built in 1910. That's the Kentuckian that we sunk in Normandy Beachhead.
Okay. Oh, you were telling me about that. Yeah. Tell everybody about this, because tell them over here. About what happened on Normandy Beach.
Well, we were chosen because the ship was so old. We weren't crippled up. We could still get underway and keep going.
But so they could sacrifice you.
They wanted the constructors here port, actually, you know, break waters and calm the water down for the soldiers to get ashore. So we were one of the ones chosen. But we pumped our excess oil off in England so we wouldn't waste it, you know.
Yeah.
And that was it.
That was if you just went into Normandy Beach in the middle of the battle, sunk the ship.
No, we anchored there all night. We didn't.
You could see the action on the shore?
Oh, yeah. They didn't. We anchored there. But they didn't.
Were you in any danger of being hit?
All the time.
I knew. Yeah. I wanted him to say
Talk
it.
About Coney Island.
Sorry.
At night. At night over there was tough. But we went in and settled down all right. It was okay.
Ever have nightmares about it?
Not really.
How can people live through things like
that? You have nightmares. Like I said, I can't sleep on a pillow.
Yeah.
But I hold it as if it's still my life jacket.
Actually, there, you didn't want to sleep because there was so much action. It was interesting.
It was interesting.
As long as you didn't get hit.
You weren't being caught sleeping either, you know.
Sleep was the last thing in your mind.
Yeah, yeah. Most people slept in a day. We slept maybe for 10 minutes at a time. Many times.
You'd be surprised.
During the course of a night.
Yeah. Half an hour nap, you recuperate right away. Yeah.
I suppose the first time that it really hits you, this is a terrible thing to say, but I know a lot of people who watch this program are older, and you always think, as kids do, it happens to somebody else, not to you.
That's right.
And
that's
it's
true.
When you start going to the funerals of your friends that it hits home that you are vulnerable.
We had three
and
Scotch boys.
You people must have, when you suddenly had somebody you knew who went down.
Fire tubes.
Now, we had Scotch boilers on the old.
He said Scotch boilers. They had the fire tubes, right? They had a danger.
Yeah, fire
yes,
tubes.
Yes.
Right.
Yep. They want to blow up very easily.
They blow up very
easily. You get gas pockets in them and they go boom.
Yeah, you can get the steam up in a hurry with the Scotch boiler.
Oh, yes. Very efficient. Yeah. Very quick.
But they,
we were on our way to Panama, which we didn't know we were going through, and one of our boilers was leaking tubes. The water was going into the firebox, which is a dangerous thing. You can't get no steam up. So the chief engineer shut down the boiler, and we put on three sets of coveralls and woolen hats and asbestos gloves, and told us now we're going to repair the tubes with expanding plugs.
Yeah. Yeah. Hmm.
Now we're doing this. Now we don't know what's going on up on deck. They're running on one boiler. The boiler we shut down is in excess of 500 degrees. Yeah, we had to take out the grates to get in there to plug the tubes.
When you're
and the second
the
engineer must have weighed 98 pounds soaking wet. And he was the first one in the boiler. And the first engineer come down, or the chief engineer came down from the bridge. He says, "Don't get excited. We're in submarine waters." Well, the second engineer, it looked like a pencil, blew up at least 10 times his size. Now, you only got a manhole this size to get in and out.
He swelled up, the heat.
Yeah, he got scared.
He got scared. Yeah. And I never thought I would see a human body blow up so much.
Oh, yeah.
So the chief engineer said, "Well, let's put some water in there." We put water, we gave him some ice to try to get him out. He couldn't shrink. So the chief engineer said,
"Put the fire hold on, the cold
no,
hole.
Didn't do it.
Are you on the same ship?
No, it's not the only situation.
We did that. It didn't work. So the chief engineer says, "All right, he's no good anyway. Close the boiler and we'll get on the way." As soon as he said that, he shot out of there. Like it was a bullet. But it was scary.
He was in a panic situation.
You know, it all seems like fun today.
Well,
when you sit back and think about it, what could have happened?
I'm scared to death.
I understand, though, that the danger didn't end when your voyages ended,
that you were
dealing with asbestos, among other things.
Oh, of course. We didn't know anything about asbestos.
Many of you have had very intimate contact with asbestos. I heard you used it on the decks to soak up the oil.
The engine room. They
used it on the bulkheads to insulate it.
Sure. Well, your pipes were cold.
Your pipes were wrapped in it.
Yeah. That's in the
fucking water.
Everything.
Steam by hand. Swatch it out of pipe.
Everyone sitting here then has had asbestos exposure.
Our lungs are half full of it. Asbestos. That's why I keep.
Oh, yes.
That's why I keep smoking.
50 years after I handled asbestos, I was informed that I had asbestosis.
Asbestosis. That's what they call it.
And you said, "Wow,
yeah.
Surprise!" Yeah. Now you find out.
50 years later.
Again, as I said in the last segment, it's amazing that the government didn't get around to recognizing the service of you people, which meant, of course, you didn't get benefits.
Right.
Until 1986,
which was President Reagan signed the order that gave us medical out of the veterans' hospitals, and a burial. We got a free burial.
Nice tombstone.
And I don't think, we're not asking for nothing more than recognition, but I don't think the GIs that were on the front lines and the rest of the services realized that every time they loaded their rifle or their pistol or their gun, that that stuff was brought over there by the merchant ships.
And the food they ate.
And the food they ate.
When I lost that ship on Omaha Beach, my pay stopped.
Oh, yeah.
You weren't saved if you weren't on the ship.
The ship wasn't working.
Pay stopped.
Ladies and gentlemen, people out there must have had relatives who were in the Merchant Marine, in any of the armed forces that were served by the Merchant Marine. If you're interested in the Staten Island chapter of the Merchant Marines and would like to get more information, whether it's about benefits, camaraderie, or to share your ideas and your memories, we have a number here for you. If you would like to get in touch with them, we have it here on the television set. It's been a very moving experience for me, finding out about it. So much I didn't know. And maybe some things I knew I forgot. I'm glad I had a chance to be reminded. And I'd like to thank you all, gentlemen, for coming here, putting your time in. I understand that some of them, too, want to come down and be a part of our team here. It's another way to change careers, just as many of you never expected you'd be in the Merchant Marine. To my left here, we have Jens, who on the first segment of this show was one of our cameramen. Now, he's had triple bypass surgery, and he's a wicked man on the camera, let me tell you. So if you would like to extend your experiences, come on down and join us as part of our crew. But in any case,
we'll train you.
Huh?
We'll train you.
We'll train you. Yeah.
Really good.
Yeah. If you can operate a ship, if you can operate a boiler room, then you can operate a camera down here, or the sound, or the music. So from 50 plus, thank you all very much, and thank you out there for watching.
Thank
Bye-bye.
You. Thank you.
Thank you.